have anything to do there, just come beside so that we can start our Bible study. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, we thank you this morning. Father, we thank you for your goodness. You are always good, Lord. We thank you, Lord God, for your mercy. You're always merciful. We thank you, Lord, because of your grace. You're always graceful, oh God. Lord, we thank you for your goodness in our lives this morning. We thank you for filling our lives with your goodness, filling our lives with your mercy, filling our lives with your love, oh God. And Father, we thank you for impressing us with life this morning, oh God. Father, we thank you for this wonderful moment, Lord God, to study your word. We thank you for your word, oh God, your word which is our life, your word which is our light, your word which is, Lord God, which sanctifies us, oh Father God. Lord, we thank you for this powerful word that we are studying this morning, God. We praise you, Father. We thank you. We give you glory, Lord. Thank you as we study this word, God. Give us understanding, Lord. Give us knowledge, Father. And we pray for a spirit of revelation, Lord. Help us, Lord. We thank you and we bless your name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. Yeah, welcome to our Bible study. Today we are winding up. I believe we'll be through with this, with the discipline today. In the name of Jesus Christ, it's been a wide topic. We've done it like over 3 months now. But we thank God today we'll be through with it, so that next week we'll start another topic. So we thank God. So last week we talked about respect. I remember we are still talking about discipline. And our memory verse was Philippians chapter 4, verse 5. Memory verse was Philippians chapter 4, verse 5. Yeah, and we've been talking about different aspects that concerns discipline. We talked about the use of our tongue. Talk about having moderation in all things. And we talked about the depths. Depths, we talked about being in debt of money. Being in debt to the promise or vows that you make and we don't fulfill them. And being in debt with the time. And we talked about punctuality at meetings. Still under discipline. And last week we talked about respect for one another, especially elders, ministers, and leaders in the church. So we got this from 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 1 and 2, then Hebrews chapter 13, verse 17, and Leviticus chapter 19, verse 32. And we talked about respect for parents. So respect for one another, especially elders, ministers, and leaders in the church. So we said, we should give due respect to whom is due. Amen. So if give an elder the respect that he deserves, give the minister the respect that he deserves, give the leaders in the church the respect that they deserve. And even those who are not in leadership, they have to be respected. Praise the Lord. So we have to respect each other as the children of God and the followers of Jesus Christ. So it doesn't mean that the leader should not respect the one that they are leading. Respect is a two-way. You respect the one you are leading, and then you're the one you are leading. You earn your respect by respecting. Praise the Lord. And so we talked about respecting the respect for the parents, and it came the respect for parents and the law of the land. We read the book of Ephesians, chapter 6, verse 1 and 3. Then Matthew, chapter 15, verse 4, if you're writing. And then 1 Peter, chapter 2, verse 13 to 17. Romans, chapter 13, 1 through 10. And then Titus, chapter 3, verse 1. And Proverbs chapter 20, verse 20. And then Proverbs chapter 30, verse 17. So we talked about rebellion against church leaders. And we talked, this rebellion, we just talk about general rebellion as a whole, generally. Because rebellion is rebellion. You start rebelling from home. When rebellion starts from home, then you become rebellious to anybody that is around you. So rebellion starts when you start, like young children, young people, and they start rebelling against their parents. When they become rebellious, they can't respect anyone outside. If you can't respect your parents, if you can't respect those who have rule of law over you, you can't respect nobody. You hear someone says, even my mom, even my dad can't tell me that. Who are you? Even my parents can't control me the way you're controlling me. Who are you? So because this person is already a rebel from home. He has rebelled against the parents. So you cannot, just another person cannot control this person. And that's why now the prisons were built. Because if your parent can't control you, who else will control you? The prison. You'll be locked up in the prison so that the walls can control you. Praise the Lord. We have a saying in Swahili, says, if you're not taught, the one who is not taught by the parents will be taught by the world. And you know the world, if you want to be taught by the world, you learn it the toughest way. So respect, if you don't have respect, so rebellion is the opposite of respect. So if you can't respect, if you can't respect those who have rule over you, then you are a rebel. You are walking in rebellion. If you are not respecting, then you are rebelling. There's nothing. There's no way you'll be in between. You are either respecting or you are rebelling. And may God help us that we will not find ourselves in between, because you will not be understood where you belong. And you have to be understood. People have to know you. You have to walk on a straight path so that people may know you well. Praise the Lord. And so we read, Brother Albert read a verse before we closed, and then I want us to go through that verse again about rebellion. We'll talk about it for 10 minutes, and then we'll do another, the last point for this discipline topic. Brother Albert, if we can read it, please. Can we get the microphone? Brother Albert is reading a scripture.
Blame Diane that I'm late. Blame Diane that I'm late. Where was it at? 1 Samuel?
Yeah, and you know, even God himself,
yeah, let me get to it,
is against rebellion. And that's why the devil and his angels were thrown out of heaven because of rebellion. And God cannot impress a rebellious person.
Okay, we're reading out of 1 Samuel 15 from verse 22 to verse 23. This verse right here is a little personal testimony to myself. Is the Lord had told me one day that I was in rebellion. And this one is the one that, how can I say, straightened me out.
1 Samuel
15, verse 22 to 23. It says, so Samuel said, has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams. For rebellion is the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is the iniquity of idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected you from being king.
Wow. So Samuel said, Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offering and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed. And to heed than the fat of rams. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry, because you have rejected the word of the Lord. He also has rejected you from being king. Amen. So we know the whole story. And if you want to know the whole story, read the whole chapter. The 15th chapter. You see why we have this conversation. He said, the Lord has great delight in burnt offering and sacrifice as in obeying the voice of the Lord. You know, God cannot be bribed. You cannot disobey God. You cannot go against the instructions of God and think that you are pleasing God in other ways. He was told to utterly destroy. He was told that Saul was told to destroy everything. Destroy animals, destroy everything. And what did he do? Verse 21, he said, but the people took of the plunder sheep and oxen, the best of the things which should have been utterly destroyed, to sacrifice to the Lord your God in Gilgal. So this is Saul trying to to convince Prophet Samuel. He say they took it. They took all this, the best of the things which should have been utterly destroyed, to sacrifice to the Lord your God in Gilgal. The Lord, the God of Samuel, not even the God of Saul. So he's trying to convince Samuel that I did this to sacrifice to your God. And he says, this is what Samuel now is asking, has the Lord as great delight in burnt offering and sacrifice as in obeying the voice of the Lord? The only thing that God has delight in is when you obey his voice, when he speaks and you obey. Because he doesn't take the sacrifice that he has not asked for. He will tell you, I want you to sacrifice this. The way he told Abraham. He will direct you what to do. But if you don't hear, God says you should go and utterly destroy. And you refuse to listen to his voice and obey. Melody, please, can you help Jason? If you can help him from outside, that would be good. So, if you listen to his voice and obey and do what he tells you to do, it may not be pleasant to you, but he's the one who has said, he sent you, so you don't do contrary to what he told you to do. So, he thought that God was hungry for the sacrifice. He thought that the mind of God is like the mind of man. That you do the wrong thing and you come and confuse with him with the gifts. This is what he was trying to do, to confuse God. So that God will say, oh, okay, so I told you to disobey, but you have brought me something, thank you. He was told to utterly destroy. See, rebel, what rebel? And say, verse 23. He say, still 22. Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice. You can give, you can sacrifice as many sacrifices as you may want to. But if you are not doing it in obedience, you are wasting the sacrifice. The sacrifice that you're sacrificing, you're wasting it because it's not going anywhere. The first thing is obedience. The people who don't obey God. The people who don't want to listen to hear the voice of God. But they think if the church needs something, if the church is in need of money, they are ready to give money. They are ready to support. They are ready to donate. They feel like they think that that will justify them. But if you're not walking in obedience, even your sacrifice is a waste. Praise the Lord. And say, and to heed them the fat of rams. To obey and to heed. So, obeying is better than sacrifice. And to heed is better than the fat of rams. You know, God was really delighted in the fat of the rams when the offering is, the burnt offering is offered, and that fat. Yeah, he was delighted in. But see what the prophet is saying here. By heeding to his voice is better than the fat of the rams. And for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. Do you know do you know who a witch is? A witch is a person who practices witchcraft. And so When we talk about witchcraft, don't think of those people who are found in the remotes of the villages practicing this devilish thing, and you think those are the witches. You may be a witch too in the house of God, practicing witchcraft by rebelling, being rebellious. And rebellion may not, you may not see it as a big deal, but maybe you want to please, you want to show the people around you that you're not an easy person. You say, did he say that? Did he say we do that? Are you guys going to do that? No, I'm a man of my own principles. I can't be moved that easily. I'm not gonna do it. Rebellion. Witchcraft. And now when you are doing that, you are bewitching the minds of these ones that are being the one to obey. Because when you tell them you are a person of your principles, you cannot easily be moved. And so they ask themselves, oh, so we are easily moved? We don't have principles? You have already bewitched their minds. So you are a witch. Don't be deceived that the witchcraft is only performed by those witches. You can also perform witchcraft by not obeying, by rebelling against the voice of God. Rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he also has rejected you from being king. You cannot reject God. You cannot reject the word of God who enthroned you to be the king and continue being the king. You cannot disobey the order of the one who put you on the throne and continue ruling as a king. Because if you are not obeying, why should you continue being the king? So rebellion is worse than a sin of witchcraft. So we should know that what we do, sometimes we take faith beyond the limits. And when we take faith beyond the limits, we find ourselves walking in rebellion and walking in stubbornness. They say, don't do this. They say, by faith, I believe. They say, if you do this, this is going to happen to you. Say, by faith, I believe my God will not allow this to happen to me in Jesus' name. They say, don't go that way. That way, there's danger that way. Say, by faith, God will send his angels to guard over me. And that will not happen to me. Stubbornness. By faith, you start misusing faith. By faith, Saul thought that he's going to offer the sacrifice to God by faith, because God had not told him to offer, but he wanted to do it by faith. What he was supposed to utterly destroy, he thought that by faith these things will be useful. Even when God had said, let us destroy them, my faith, I believe that these things will be useful. So rebellion. It may seem like you are just okay with it. You want people to understand, you want people to know your principles, but you're walking in rebellion. And that may cause you not to see heaven, But God, may God help us that we will not walk in rebellion in Jesus' name. So, anyone who wants to walk, to add on that? Talking about rebellion. And just going through 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 22 and 23.
Try to, I mean, you can't fool God. You can't fool God. And this perfect example, how he even tried in 24, he says, I feared the people. He tried to shift the blame to the people on why he did what he did. And then, you know, Samuel was being, you know, supportive towards him. However, God kept trying to tell him, look, it's done. So, you know, God could see through man. Whether he's genuine or not.
Wow. Can you imagine Saul even went as far as preserving or saving the life of the king that he was supposed even to destroy? But he saved the fat cows, the fat sheep, and the king also. Against the will of God. So let's talk about this.
Praise the Lord. You know, this is one of those heavy scriptures. That when you read, you want to read again and again and again. Because from the way Saul became king, it was a mystery. You know, he qualified to become king because of how people saw him and not how God saw him. And people demanded for him to become king over them because he was this tall man and strong. And so people looked at the outward look of Saul, and they felt this man is a strong man. He can fight the battle. He can win the battles. We need this man to be our king. And so when I read this scripture, I look at that, and I reflect also on the way we look at things as men. We look at some situations and we feel this is what I want. I have to be here. I have to get this. I have to hold on to this. This is the right thing for me. And God says, wait a minute, wait upon me, I'll show you the best. And you feel, no, if I let this one go, I'll never get another one. This is it. And the same spirit of looking at the outward appearance of Saul, the same thing when Saul went for this assignment, he was looking at the things which were pleasing unto the eye. And he said, oh, this is a king, we can't kill the king. Look at these fat cows and rams. We can't kill this. Let's preserve them. You know, we do that all the time. You know, you see somebody who has come in and he has all these, you know, accolades and big names and recognitions. And you say, oh, this is a mighty man. Give him the front seat. And maybe he's the witch that we are talking about here. I remember back in the days, I was a member of a church, which was a non-Pentecostal church, and the chairman of the development was known to be somebody who used to practice sorcery, but this chairman was in charge of the church development. He was the one who used to take care of every development activity. He had money, so you take care of everything that the church needed. You know, is it building? Is it buying furniture? This man will do everything. But the whole community knew that this man was a sorcerer. But because of his wealth and his big name, he remained as the chairman of church development. And that is the same thing that Saul was doing, you know. And we do this all the time. And we walk in disobedience. You know, so there's a lot of things we can learn from that.
Praise the Lord. I was just, you know, looking at the verse 23, I was just pondering on why God decided to compare being rebellion with a sin of witchcraft. These new days that we are in, this new era now, it's rebellion might not be those language that's common that people are, you know, talking about. But when you hear people saying witchcraft, witchcraft, witchcraft. So now that the Bible is really now opening our eyes, how deep, how bad, how horrible this sin of rebellion is, comparing it to witchcraft, it means that it's so bad. Because we know that people that practice witchcraft, people, we all believe that, you know, we all know what, who they are, you know, we all have this thing at the back of our mind that witchcraft is evil, witchcraft is bad, witchcraft is not of God. But for God to now telling you that it's not only that witchcraft, you that disobeying the word of God, you as worst as witchcraft. Then it goes further. Stubbornness is same thing. So that means, like we said on Monday, Zoom, a sin is a sin. So what, even that tiny being stubborn, they tell you do this, get out of that place, you know, go to the other side. No, I can't do it. Like Pastor said, no, who are you to tell me that? I am a man of my own word, you know. You don't pay my bill, I pay my own bill. You don't tell me what to do. No, because I don't pay your bill, you don't pay my bill. The stubbornness, spirit of stubbornness kicked in. And guess what? The Bible is comparing that. Being stubborn is as worse as idolatry. So it is not different between you that just committed adultery and me that being stubborn. Praise the Lord. We both got caught in the act. You got caught in your own act of adultery. Me, I got caught in my own act of stubbornness and fornication. See, these are the little tiny stuffs that is not being preached out there, that when you read the word of God, your eyes, you start seeing things like, wow, adultery. Back in the days, if you commit adultery in the Bible, in the holy days, they will say, bring the woman out. Let's stone him to death. We're going to kill him. We're going to kill her. In Nigeria, back then, if you get caught, they throw you, they strip you naked. You that you stubborn, you should be punished as such, because the Bible is comparing you being stubborn, your stubbornness and adultery together. Praise the Lord. So when we are doing things, we need to be very conscious. It's in the Bible, it's in the Word of God. The Word of God is there to lighten us, to open our eyes, so we can see the mirror of ourselves. You look at yourself in the mirror as we look at ourselves in the Word of God. And the one thing that really, really shocked me is when it says, the stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. And because thou hast rejected the Word of God. So because you've rejected the Word of God, it's now telling you, you that are so stubborn, you that you're rebellious, you are as bad, you've committed the same. You should be judged as such. And God will help us in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen. Wow. So how about going to places where God cannot go with you? Going to places where God cannot go with you. Let's read 2 Timothy chapter 2. Verse 19 through 24. So if you go to a place where God cannot go with you, that means you are still rebelling against God, because God wants to walk with you. He wants He wants you to walk together with him. But if you go to a place where he cannot go with you, you are walking as a rebel because you're not walking with him. It says, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19 to 24. It says, nevertheless, the solid foundation of God stands, having this seal: the Lord knows those who are his. And let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. But in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, some for honor and some for dishonor. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter, he will be a vessel for honor, sanctified and useful for the master, prepared for every good work. Flee also youthful lusts, but pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Not just those who call on the Lord. Those who call on the Lord out of the pure heart. But avoid foolish and ignorant disputes, knowing that they generate strife. And a servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach and be patient. Let's read again 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 22. 1 Thessalonians 5, 22. It says, abstain from all appearances of evil. Is that all? So this, we are talking about going to places where God cannot go with you. For example, going to dancing halls, cinema halls, all the revealings. Where God cannot go with you. Going to parties. That you know this party, honestly, I cannot, I'm not comfortable as a believer. I can't even step my feet in this because here, honestly, God is not with me here. If I'm here, I'm here alone. And Mami Kim sometimes talks about going outside the Lord's covering. Because where he cannot go with you, that means his covering is not on you, is not with you. So you are there by yourself. If anything happens to you, don't blame him. Because you left him, you went alone. And you see, I see people, like many people sing songs, say, Lord, don't leave me, don't let me fall, don't let me, don't leave my hand. It's you who leaves God's hand. It's not God. I say, don't leave me to die. Don't leave me to experience troubles. But if you, it's you yourself who wants to experience that, God cannot fight with you. He wants to hold your hand, but you say, let me hold. God, don't hold my hand. Let me hold yours. And when you want to let go of God's hand, you just let it go and you go. But if you allow God to hold your hand, even when you want to go, he will not allow you to go. But if it's you who is holding, whenever you feel like letting it go, you let it go. And so walking with God, it means letting him hold your hand. Because if he sees that there's danger, he will hold you tight, that you'll not go where you want, where you are, your desires are leading you to go. So is going to cinemas, dancing halls, and all these parties that does not glorify God, is it good for a believer? Let's talk about this. So long as I'm not drinking, so long as I'm not doing what they're doing, I'm just taking care of myself, I'm taking care of my faith. I go there, sit there, read my Bible. I go there with my Bible. When they're drinking, I'm reading the Bible. Is it good in the first place to be in those places? Let's talk. Are we allowed to do that?
So you have not been covered. The safety of God is nowhere to be found in that place.
Yes.
But somebody I was talking to the other day caught me, was now, you know, I didn't do this. But what were you there in the first place? Who was a child of God doing outside of the covering of home at 1 a.m. for Christ's sake? Well, just hanging out with my friends. Now you've been set up. Now you didn't do anything. Everybody that was there, they all packed them. Now you're on your way to prison. It just doesn't add up.
So a child of God outside at
1 a.m.
not attending to any assignment of God, or not attending the prayer meeting.
He was just with his friend hanging out. They were just drinking. But I didn't. You know me, I don't drink. But what are you doing there at 1 a.m.? And that was the question I kept asking. He could not answer, but still, now you got caught up. Don't call me. Yeah. It is some things that it's bizarre. You know, and the next thing they say, you are just too blunt. It's not, you know the truth. You've been warned, don't do it. Then don't do it. Yeah. 1 a.m., you should be laying down, resting your mind, be sleeping at peace. Even if you go out at 10, come back home, find something. Don't let it stay too long, because the covering is already appearing to be evil anyways. At 1 a.m. you should be sleeping, resting, getting yourself ready for the next day. Praise the Lord. So those are the things that we need to want to put yourself in a curfew. If it's 10 o'clock, no matter what they are doing, 9 o'clock. Even now, these days, this gunshot, shooting everywhere, 7 o'clock, it doesn't even matter. It doesn't even take to 2 a.m. anymore. Praise the Lord. There was on the news the other day, maybe a couple of months ago, all these young Clovis and North kids, 18, 17 years old, at, you know, midnight, driving around. They were just driving around. Now they got an accident, ran into another house, killed that old woman. No, we didn't do it. We were not influenced. John, what were you doing? Where's your parents at midnight, for Christ's sake, age 17 years old? They were just hanging out. Okay, now you find yourself. So those are the things that we need to start teaching ourselves, teaching the young kids, encouraging them that the world is full of evil. The Bible already tell you, stay away. And I tell my kids, if it's 10 o'clock, please go and rest your brain. Get yourself ready. The people you are watching on the TV, they are making more money. They are getting richer. You, that you are watching them, you are giving them your own lifetime. You watch them from, what have you gained from them other than watching them? Turn the TV on, commercial, they make money off you because your internet is on, your everything is on. So you are helping them to become richer. And you, that you are watching them, you have just been destroyed. Praise the Lord. So give yourself, think about it, and use your time wisely, like we said last week, and God will help us. Stay away everything that appears to be evil, and God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen. And this reminds me when I was talking to my son, was it last year? Mom, you know, you really control me so much, mommy. I can't drink. You know me. He said, mommy, you know me. I can't involve myself in the groups that do all these bad evil things. I told him it's not about doing this evil thing. But sometimes you'll find yourself in that environment. And when you find yourself in that environment, you and all those who are in that environment. So one day he told me, mommy, my friend, I think he had it was a graduation party for the year 2019. He said, my friend, invited me to this party. It's just a 1 hour party. I asked him, do you know anybody? He said one of his friends in this church said he is also there. He's the one who invited me. I said, but be. I said, I'm not allowing you to go. He said, mommy, why can't you just me allow me for this one day? And let me prove it to you that I'm not that bad boy. And I said, go. It didn't take 30 minutes, he was back. I asked, what happened? He said, mommy, you can't believe. What happened? He said, when you just entered that house, the neighbor called the police. He said that there are young boys here, they are doing drugs. And the police came. And so when they came, they say, okay, bring your IDs. Bring your IDs. And you know, my son now facing the police for the first time. He said, how old are you? He said, I'm 18. Bring your ID. He was not 18. And he said, my ID is in the car. He said, okay, go bring it. So when he went, so when he entered the car and left. And he said, mommy, now I believe. I understand what you've been telling me. I said, did you see any drug in that house? He said, no. But the police came because they got a report that there were drugs. You were doing drugs in that house. Say, so don't just be where God doesn't want you to go. Don't go. But Albert wants to say something.
Praise the Lord. Talking about rebellion, you know, that was the first sin of man. One, Lucifer rebelled in heaven and was thrown out, and it caused the first man that God created to also rebel. Because when God said, do not touch, and Satan came and said, does it really mean you should not touch? Will this really happen? Why don't you touch and see? And that is exactly what rebellion is. You know the instruction, but what if I go against this? What will happen? And that's why God is very, very particular about the issues of rebellion. Because that was what brought down the work of his creation. That he now needed to send his only son to bring back restoration. So that's why we must be very sensitive regarding issues of rebellion. And it creeps in subtly, and it creeps in quietly, and before you know it, the rebellion becomes so obvious. It might even start from your heart, not your action. You hear the word, you hear the instruction, and you just feel, why is it asking me to do this? But you do it anyways. But gradually, you become more emboldened, and you neglect it. And that could cause a serious issue in terms of our spiritual life and walk with God. Idolatry, God related stubbornness to idolatry, which is like you serving another god. It's you, when your heart is stubborn against the instruction given, then that means you believe in a bigger god that you think you ought to respond to. In terms of being fleeing from every appearance of evil, that is, you know, let's be going to watch a movie. I don't think it's a sin. You can go to watch a movie. But now, hanging out with people that you don't have the same conviction about, it is the association that matters. If you and your family decide to go and watch a movie, there is nothing wrong. You finish. That you're only associating with your family in that environment. But when you now go and associate with others that don't have the same conviction with you, and they are doing what you know God is not in line with, and you know God cannot be in the presence of this kind of evil, then you are strongly advise not to be a part of that. Sometimes we go to places because we want to evangelize. This is the only way you can get the attention of that person. So your motive must be very clear. Like there is somebody, okay, this is the only way, and the Holy Spirit really gives you that conviction. Go and share with this person here. You must really know why you are there and what you are there for. But as much as we have the ability, let us avoid every appearance of evil. You may be able to tell yourself you are not doing anything bad, But there's somebody out there that you may not have the opportunity to explain what you are doing, and you will just have that perception. And sometimes perception is stronger than reality. And it is that perception that will go out there that will ultimately undermine your ability to reach out and to minister to people around you. Why? Because they have the wrong perception. That will not affect your going to heaven, but it might hinder your ability to do the works that you are meant to do here because of wrong association, wrong perception, based on where being in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Amen.
God will guide us and help us even as we take heed to these issues of discipline in the name of Jesus.
Amen. And just one more question, Pastor. For example, I am a lady and I go to the gym and my instructor is a man. I am born again. My instructor, who is a man, is not born again. Is it good for me? Because, you know, there are those workouts that I really don't feel like. I, being a lady, born again lady, he's an instructor, he's helping me with the workout. And is it right?
What I think, when you do things like this, is the intention that matters. First off, I am going to the gym because I have a goal. I don't care about anybody else. I don't care about why other people are there. I am going there because I have a goal. And the goal is to be healthier. The goal is to have the kind of body that I want through the gym. Now, you cannot do these things by yourself. This is why you have an instructor. Sometimes. Now, it depends on, it doesn't matter what the workout is. The instructor is not on top of you. The instructor is not forcing you. All of these things, you do them based on your own intention. When you have a separate intention, then you begin to see things as though they were. You know what I'm saying? So my point is, it doesn't matter whether the instructor is born again or not. What matters is your intention for going to the gym. You'll be amazed that people go to the gym for different reasons. You know, this is because it's my situation. So.
Okay, Pastor, as you wind up and pray for us.
I believe we'll table that for another day. Let's pray. Father, Lord, we thank you this morning. We give you praise. We give you all the glory. Lord, you have taken us through this study of undiscipline. Discipline in our timing, discipline in our respect for